Hello.
So can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah. And there are people here who don't understand Danish, right? Yeah. So I'll do the talk in somewhat broken English. Yeah. First of all, thanks a lot for having me here. And second of all, thanks a lot for doing this wonderful event here, Bornhack in Bornholm. A long time ago, someone, I think it was Kramse, pulled me aside during a conference somewhere and said, "We're thinking about doing a Danish hacker festival." And I said, "Oh yeah, great." He said, "In Bornholm." And I said, "Okay, sounds like a great idea." But I wasn't completely honest when I said it sounded like a great idea. I privately thought, what a horrible, batshit, crazy, loony idea. No one will show up, it'll be a disaster. You don't know what you're doing. But never underestimate the power of geeks, I guess, because here we are and this is fucking awesome. So can all the organizers please stand up? Stand up, organizers. So when people run around saying another world is possible, they say, fuck you, it's already here. Well, I'll be talking about a lot of really, really depressing stuff, and I'm not a very fun guy to listen to, so you might be depressed. But I'll start at a lighter note. As some of you maybe know, I'm running this crowdfund where a lot of people, a lot of these people here, throw money my way so I have more time to write and give lectures and all this. So thanks for that. But one of the things about this Patreon crowdfund is that someone talked me into when I made this a year ago, you have to give people who donate money to you some perks. And I said, oh, well, what kind of perks? A thank you note, or yeah, that's good, but you have to have something that's bigger. Okay, so maybe if I post a picture once a month with me with a shoe on my head, and then yeah, that's good, but you have to have something that's even bigger, because otherwise people won't buy the one with the shoe on the head. Okay, so what if I don't know, maybe it's naked on those pictures with that shoe on my head? And he said, yeah, that's it. Nobody will ever pay for it, but it'll look good and you'll get a lot of money. Well, turns out he was wrong, because some people were willing to pay a lot of money for pictures of me naked. So, did any of you see Emma Holten speak yesterday about revenge porn? Well, consent is key, so, wrong way. Here's the newest picture. And the reason I'm posting it here, just in this, oh, there's a camera, yeah, is that I've been very bad at, I'm supposed to do this once a month, but, you know, I haven't done it always, so I'm very sorry. Two people here, I owe you some pictures of me naked, and that's really a sentence I never expected to have to say out loud, but here you go, yeah. I'll be talking about surveillance a bit, and whistleblowing a bit, and Snowden a bit, and yelling at politicians a bit, and yelling at media a bit. But one of the key difficulties, and I know, I'm pretty sure you all know this, is when we're talking about surveillance, sometimes it's quite hard to get people to understand why it matters. They know maybe in some British aerospace, electronics, something, something. And they're really shitty people. And here they are, the board of directors and who founded the company. And I think maybe they should have to look over their shoulders a bit. And I couldn't help to think about Hacking Team, who got hacked. And I think there was a talk about this yesterday, right? And the hacker who took them down, he had this quote that I think is really good. "It's all it takes to take down a company and stop the human rights abuses. That's the beauty and asymmetry of hacking. With hundreds of hours of work, one person can undo years of work by a multi-million dollar company. Hacking gives the underdog a chance to fight and win." So I think we should do that. And I'm pretty sure it's illegal to say that out loud, so I'm saying it again. I think these people should be hacked and have their secrets on the internet for all to see. Actually, I won't be talking that much about hackers, because I'm not really a technical guy myself, but the first hack I ever heard about was before the age of computers. It was in 1971, where a bunch of anti-war activists broke into the office of FBI in a little town called Media in Pennsylvania and stole a lot of records and sent some of the records to the media. Because these dudes and women dudes, they had the impression that FBI was engaged in illegal surveillance and impersonating of anti-war activists and all kinds of bad behavior. Pretty much like today, but before the age of electronics, and they turned out to be right. So ultimately, the head of the FBI, J. Edgar Hoover, he had to resign in disgrace because these people hacked the FBI. And of course, this broader society and that we are engaged in what I would call a war on whistleblowers, and that's shit, because what a whistleblower does is actually quite relevant to the notion of democracy, unless you think that democracy is just voting for some stupid, or not stupid, sorry, there are some politicians here, and I have to be excellent to them too. Democracy isn't just voting. Democracy is that the public knows what's going on, that the people in power are acting on our behalf. And without information, that's pretty much stupid. If we don't know what's being done in our name, how can we condone it or allow it to continue? Actually, I think that's what democracy is. That's us having a check on people in power. Them being afraid of us, not physically, but afraid to get kicked out of office. There's a famous quote from Henry Kissinger, who was in the White House with President Nixon during the Vietnam War, and there were giant demonstrations outside, and the White House security had parked buses all the way around the White House to protect the people inside from the angry mob outside. And Nixon said to Kissinger, "Henry, I'm afraid they might come and take us." And that's exactly what we want, not actually to take them, but have them quiver in fear. I think I made my point. So I'll be talking a bit about Snowden. Edward Snowden, who is perhaps the most well-known whistleblower these days. I'll get back to principals and other whistleblowers in a little while. But everybody knows Edward Snowden, and we all know pretty much what he disclosed. This is the court order to Verizon, the giant American telecommunications company. That was the first Snowden story ever before people even knew the name Edward Snowden. And that story is about Verizon having to hand over records on all their customers every day, who calls who, when, how long, and a lot of technical stuff. And when the story broke, the Obama administration, who is horrible on these issues, tried to say, well, this is about catching foreign terrorists. But unluckily for Obama, the whole court order was leaked, and in it it says, "This order does not require Verizon to produce telephony metadata for communications wholly originating and terminating in foreign countries." So it's actually only about American phone calls. So that's bad if you're trying to spin the foreign terrorist angle. Somebody here at a debate earlier today mentioned sessionslogning or logningbekendtgørelsen, which is basically the same thing as this. In Denmark, it's just done in the open without secret court orders. That's even shittier, I think. The next big Snowden story was Prism. And basically, it's just all those companies in the blue box, Microsoft, Google, Yahoo. Can you read it from down there? Yeah, we all know the companies. Who have given NSA access, directly access to pretty much everything their customers does. And that's really shitty when your slogan is something like, "We care about your privacy." So that's bad, but it's even better that it turned out that NSA also hacked Google and Yahoo. They figured out where they could access the internal cloud services of Google and pull out everything unencrypted. So that's the only story that really made the technicians at Google and Yahoo mad as hell, and that's quite clear why, because not only had these companies already bent it all backwards to help NSA spy on all of us, but at the same time, NSA fuck them in the back door. Oh, yeah. So that's bad. This is my favorite story, actually. It's about GCHQ, the British equivalent to NSA, and it's called Optic Nerve. It's a program to tap webcam images from as many users as possible. It turns out that somewhere between 4 and 11% of all webcam images pulled from people around the world contains nudity or people having sex. Actually, they say, it would appear that a surprising number of people use webcam conversations to show intimate parts of their body to the other person. They didn't see that coming. And that caused a dilemma for the people at GCHQ, because they could somehow sense there were moral implications here. And that's good, I guess. That's pretty good, I guess, because normally it doesn't seem like they are at all oblivious to that there are moral implications of spying on everybody. But unfortunately, what they thought was the moral complication here is that it's too bad that our analyst has to watch this nudity. It's not because it's not very good for the people being watched, it's that it's not fair to the watcher. So this is the only program where they allowed the analyst to say, I don't want to do this. If only they could find a replacement themselves. Also, they had 1 hour per week of psychological counseling if needed. You couldn't make it up. It also turns out they record telephone calls, full audio, from 2010, I believe. It's a pilot project at then with 5 countries, including the well-known terrorist paradise of Bahamas. And the unnamed country is Afghanistan, but the journalist who published this didn't dare to mention it. So maybe you've heard Obama or something, some other politician say, well, don't worry, it's just metadata, not content. Well, that's a fucking lie, both because of the prison program and because of this. I'm pretty confident that there are more than 5 countries in this program now. And one of these countries, I'm pretty sure, is the US itself, because an FBI agent accidentally slipped on TV and said about this Boston Marathon bombing, yeah, it's no problem figuring out who did it, because we can just listen to the phone calls from last week. Or, I mean, no, we can't. But yeah, cats out the bag. So there are also undersea fiber optic cables connecting Bornholm to the rest of Denmark and Sweden and generally around the world. Turns out that NSA has a secret program to tap into these communication lines. So that's not somebody's Google or somebody's Facebook or somebody's porn viewing. It's all of the internet, all of the time. It turns out that some of these cable tapping programs, how do you do it? How do you just, you know, go to the company and say, hey, we want to copy everything? And maybe you do that sometimes, but sometimes you do something else. You use a cover. And the cover is an overt COMSAT effort. So that's an old base that's supposed to be looking at satellite signals from Russia or whoever. But nowadays, almost no traffic goes by satellites. So here's the one in Denmark, for instance, in Jørring. 6 domes and a whole lot of cars. So you tell me, where do these people work? There are so many cars and just tiny house. So I went on Google Street View and I found this picture. Seems like they're building underground and isolating something. It's a rockwool. What the fuck is that called in English? Yeah. And then one day you can read in the Danish newspaper Information, because somehow they got access to the Snowden materials, and if it's illegal, I had nothing to do with it. This is an internal memo from the NSA about paying a visit to the Danish intelligence services. I believe there's a few here today, actually, who works for Danish Defense Intelligence Services. I hope you are having a good time. And also, if you have some secrets, you know where to contact me. So basically, this is Denmark playing a key part in a huge covert NSA program to copy everything on the internet. That's a fucking big deal, and it's fucking illegal. So what do they do with all this data? Well, they have XKeyscore, which is their own NSA's Google. So they put everything in there, and then an analyst, lots of analysts, in a lot of different places in the world, including Denmark, I've heard, can pull up everything. So you can say, well, my phone number is, and then you pull up everything on me, not just related to my phone, but inside the system, I'm graphed out like phone numbers, social security numbers, addresses, social media accounts, email addresses, wah, 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 wah. So that's basically my whole life. Unless we encrypt, of course. So that's what NSA does with it. But they also have another Google called IC Reach. And that's a way of letting everybody else have access. CIA, FBI, Defense Intelligence Agency, Drug Enforcement Agency, GCHQ, other countries. And if you go down the documents, you can see they're allowed to share this stuff with companies, foreign powers, even private individuals, whatever that means. So here is their list of customers, and they do call it customers. That's the original top secret slide. And of course, there's CIA and all those stuff we would expect there to be, but there's also agriculture and justice and treasury and commerce and US trade representatives. So that doesn't sound a whole lot like terrorism. That sounds a bit more like what we're used to see in the area of spying, industrial espionage, political control, ordinary crime. I guess many of you people have been saying for maybe even longer than me before Snowden that NSA and other intelligence services are spying on everybody and want to spy on as much as possible, and we were paranoid tinfoil loony conspiracy theorists. But luckily we don't have to take our mind, Snowden's word for it anymore, because now we have NSA's own collection posture. This is what they show to their partners when, what are you trying to do? Well, we're trying to sniff it all, know it all, collect it all, process it all, exploit it all, partner it all. Well, that's settled then. The reason we know all this stuff, and I'll get back to in a bit why that's not exactly right, but for now, the reason we know all this stuff is, of course, Edward Snowden, who is still in Russia, by the way, instead of being here, for instance. And you can see how important it is for NSA and Obama and our own government to make an example out of Snowden and make sure that he had the same fate as most other whistleblowers have had, and that's decades in a rubber cell somewhere, orange jumpsuit. They were so eager to get their hands on him that they, maybe you remember this, in late 2013, they thought he was on board the plane of the Bolivian president, Evo Morales, who was returning from Moscow. So they got their allies, European countries, France, Spain, Portugal, Italy, Austria, to close the airspace for this head of state and force his plane to land. And then they looted the plane and looked for Snowden, who of course wasn't there, because actually he was leaving from a totally different airport than the one that Snowden was in, but who cares? And now we are talking about flights. I had quite a scoop early this year, including this, which of course is a FOIA request sent to the Danish Ministry of Justice about, there were some rumors about an FBI plane here in Denmark, in Copenhagen, that was holding on the runway, involved in some kind of plot to rendition Snowden back to the US. So I filed a FOIA request, and after a very, very long time, and lots of complaints and threats to sue them, they finally gave me this. And a bunch of other stuff that looked like this. I think that they expected me to just say, okay, well, there's nothing there, but I'm pretty stubborn. So I figured out who all the people are who are CC'd, and turned out they're high-level officials in Ministry of Justice, Ministry of State, and Ministry of, I don't know. And in the end, finally found the landing permit for this plane that they denied was ever sent here to pick up Snowden. So now we know, and our Ministry of Justice had to apologize to Parliament for lying to them, and then he had to come clean and say, yeah, well, this plane was here. But of course, it had to return home after a week because Snowden didn't arrive in Denmark and Russia didn't extradite him. So he's still on the loose. This is actually a picture from his girlfriend. I think it's pretty good humor. Where's Waldo? Well, in front of the J. Edgar Hoover building. I said before, it's not quite right to say we know this just because of Snowden. It is right to say that now we know this, and Snowden told us, but actually, not many people know who this is. This is Katharina Gunn. She was a British analyst in GCHQ, and she informed us back in 2002 about spying run amok, about spying on the United Nations, trying to coerce countries into voting for the Iraq war resolution. Of course, she was fired and had her life destroyed. Not many people know this guy. He's Thomas Tam. He's a Department of Justice employee, was a lawyer in the US. And he leaked to the New York Times in 2004 that President Bush was spying on basically everybody. And not many people know Bill Binney, who is perhaps one of the greatest mathematicians alive today. He used to work in the NSA for 40 years. He invented many of the programs that are now being used to spy on us, and he quit in October of 2001 because he saw that these programs were being turned inwards and made spied on the US and on us instead of the Russian military. His life has been destroyed. There's a very good movie about him called The Good American. You should go check it out. I can say he's been in Copenhagen a lot of times at work for many years ago, but he's been here a few times the past few years, and it gives me some street credit, I think. He's in a wheelchair, so I've been pushing him around Copenhagen. So to be able to say I'm pushing around former CIA director, NSA directors, that's pretty good, but we're friendly. This is Thomas Drake, probably one of the bravest men I've ever met. He started to work in NSA on September 11th, 2001, and he was tasked with figuring out how come they didn't detect the plot, 9/11 plot. So he did, and it turns out that they had all the information in their databases. They had intercepted calls and emails from Al-Qaeda people in Yemen to the US, and nothing was done about it because they were too busy spying on everybody else. He had his life destroyed too. He was facing, I think, 70 years in prison for talking to a reporter, not even disclosing classified information. And the case collapsed, of course, and the judge said that the US government should be ashamed for putting Mr. Drake through hell for no good reason. Now he works in an Apple store. This is John Crane, who his great-grandfather actually once faced down Hitler. When Hitler first tried to coup his way to power in Germany, his grandfather stood in his way and said, "Mr. Hitler, you're never going to save Germany like this," when he pointed a gun at someone. So Hitler returned, went out of the building where he was supposed to make this coup and got arrested. Now he, John Crane, he was the Pentagon's inspector general who was overseeing whistleblower cases, making sure the whistleblowers was fairly treated and that whistleblowers wasn't retaliated against. So when Thomas Drake and the others were unfairly treated and retaliated against, he spoke out internally in the NSA, and he was retaliated against. He just went public last month, 2 months ago, I think. And unless something very bad happens to him, his case is going to end with prison time for high-level US officials. So why don't we know, most people don't know, all those faces are just paraded in front of you? Well, on the internet there is this rule, pixel it didn't happen. For whistleblowers there is a quite similar rule, documents or it didn't happen. So the reason we know Snowden's name, and Snowden is somewhat safe while all these other people had their lives destroyed and nobody knows their names, is that they didn't provide documents. They just said it to a journalist. So there's spying going on, journalist writes, someone says spying is going on, the government denies it. Goodbye. It's pretty hard to argue with 10,000 top secret documents like the ones I just showed you before. So now this established fact that the spying is run amok and going on all over the place. We still have to figure out what the hell we're going to do about it, but some of you have some great ideas. And anyway, all those whistleblowers are NSA related. Oh. It didn't start there, of course. This is the first major whistleblower. How many of you know who he is? Okay, a few of you. That's Daniel Ellsberg. He leaked 7,000 top secret pages, history of the Vietnam War, during the Vietnam War. He was working at the RAND Corporation, which is a think tank under the Department of Defense. And this story was an internal view of the Vietnam War. Why did they fight it? How was it going? Could it ever be won? How many soldiers did the Vietnamese have? And everything in that report contradicted what numerous American presidents had said publicly, spanning 10 years perhaps. So while different US presidents had been lying to the public and 58,000 American soldiers and God knows how many, 3 million Vietnamese and Cambodians and Laos civilians had died, they knew all along that the war was being fought on false pretenses, that we'll never win. It's basically a war of liberation and we are the aggressor. He leaked it to the New York Times and was, of course, charged with espionage and treason. Pretty much like, you know, when Snowden stepped forward, people started saying, well, he's a Chinese spy. Then he went from China to Moscow. So now he's, of course, a Russian spy. Same thing happened to Daniel Ellsberg. He was, of course, a Russian or a Chinese, or maybe a Russian-Chinese spy, which, of course, he wasn't. He was actually a Cold War hawk. Like Snowden, he was a kind of a conservative. But who cares about facts? Anyway, he was charged with treason and all this stuff. And ultimately, his case was thrown out of the court system because President Nixon had some goons break into his psychiatrist's office and pilfered through the files to find something they could use to blackmail him or make him look bad in the press. And back then, at least, the court system couldn't have that. I'm pretty sure today it wouldn't be such a huge problem, but maybe it's just me. Ultimately, he was vindicated. And he's probably the best example of a whistleblower who has gone on to be a hero. He's almost universally admired in the US, and he's a very old man now, of course, but he's speaking out in favor of Snowden and all the others too, and they don't really like that because they like to say, well, Daniel Ellsberg was the good guy and Snowden is a traitor. So it's not very good when Ellsberg himself says, well, actually, I am Snowden and I am Chelsea Manning or whatever. Which brings us to Chelsea Manning. She was, back then, a he who leaked a lot of documents from the US Army and from the US diplomatic services to WikiLeaks, of course. Information about the Iraq War, Afghanistan war, and a lot of corruption and pollution and war crimes and torture and stuff. Here in Denmark, she's now serving 35 years in a military prison, being denied medical care and often being denied even talking to her lawyers because home of the free, land of the brave. Here in Denmark, we have Frank Grevil, who was a major in the Danish Defense Intelligence Agency during the Iraq War. And he grew so tired, he was actually a supporter of the war when it started, but he grew so tired of hearing our Prime Minister Anders Fogh Rasmussen lie about why we had to invade Iraq. Our Prime Minister said weapons of mass destruction all the time. The problem was that Frank, who's full disclosure, my very good friend, now, not back then, he was the guy who was responsible for writing the reports about what Danish military intelligence knew about Saddam Hussein and weapons of mass destruction, and all those reports ever said was, we have no fucking idea. There's nothing to indicate that Saddam Hussein has an active program, blah, blah, blah. But our Prime Minister here in Denmark, he nevertheless went on TV repeatedly and said, well, my intelligence services says that, so he leaked the documents. Well, Frank was convicted to 6 months in prison, while our Prime Minister, who is, well, guilty of war crimes, went on to become head of NATO. So crime does pay. Actually, thanks to Chelsea Manning and WikiLeaks, we now also know why Anders Fogh Rasmussen, the Danish Prime Minister, was promoted to being head of NATO, because we have a leaked document from the US Embassy in Copenhagen saying that Turkey accepted to make Anders Fogh Rasmussen head of NATO. Turkey is a NATO member. If just Anders Fogh Rasmussen, the Danish Prime Minister, would disregard Danish law and close down a small Kurdish TV station that was operating from Denmark. Danish pledges to intensify efforts against Russia TV among the measures offered Turkey for not blocking former Prime Minister Rasmussen's appointment as NATO Secretary General have given additional impetus to the investigation into the Kurdish TV station. So of course this is blatantly illegal and corruption. And of course he should be in prison, not Frank. This is John Kiriakou, who is a CIA agent. Was a CIA agent. He's the only person to have done jail time for torture. Well, the recent torture of the war on terror prisoners around the world, black side CIA prisons. The problem is, he didn't torture anybody. But he told the media that it was being done, waterboarding and all that. that we can't have. So he just finished his 5-year, I think, prison sentence where he was being denied visitation rights, so he couldn't see his children, which is illegal, but they did it anyway because they didn't want him talking to the press and he didn't want to stop talking to the press. He gave Edward Snowden one piece of advice. Never, ever talk to the FBI. This is the Danish equivalent of John Kiriakou. It is Anders Kærgaard, who was a Danish soldier in Iraq and who witnessed Danish responsibility for torture of Iraqi prisoners of war. Innocent people who had done nothing wrong, and they were being beaten severely and tortured for 40 days, several of them died. They're not trying to, prisoners, torture victims, are trying to sue the Danish military and Danish state for allowing this to happen and for lying about it. And so far, no luck. It's only been, 13 years. Of course, no one had been held responsible for this torture except for Anders, who was fined for not revealing who gave him a video of the incident. Also, they demanded jail time, but he escaped somehow. This is Jeffrey Sterling, another CIA dude who is doing prison right now. He's being accused of having revealed a stupid, idiotic, moronic plot hatched in the CIA. The plan was, we think Iran wants a nuclear weapons program, so we're going to give one to them, a nuclear weapons program, but we'll, in the blueprint, we'll make a tiny mistake, so when they build the weapon, it won't work. Ha ha ha. We are so clever. So they did that. They actually gave Iran the blueprints for how to build a nuclear bomb. The problem was, of course, Iran has pretty good scientists. So they looked at these blueprints and said, well, this looks good, but this should be 19 instead of 80. So they changed it back, and voila, they had a fully functional nuclear weapons program thanks to the CIA. And he allegedly revealed this to James Risen, who is a New York Times journalist. He was ultimately convicted in the US courts of law, not because they could prove he had said anything at all about this to James Risen, but because they could produce phone logs showing that he did call James Risen. So metadata put you in prison. So it's not all about torture and war and spying, it's also about money. This is the SwissLeaks case, where someone from inside a huge Swiss bank gave documents to the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists about how Switzerland basically rips off everybody and lets people get away with murder, so to speak. This is Antoine Deltour, who's an accountant in Luxembourg and is the source behind the LuxLeaks. Of course, Luxembourg has a, I think Khan knows a lot about the details here. Is Khan here? Oh yeah, you probably know a lot. I don't really. But basically it's about Luxembourg giving very good terms to businesses relocating there. And he exposed some of the shady dealings, and now he was just sentenced to prison. I think he just appealed his sentence last week or 2 weeks ago. And of course, when we're talking about economic stuff, there's the Panama Papers, where someone, maybe a hacker, maybe an insider, leaked a shitload of information to a German newspaper and also to the International Consortium of Investigative Journalists. This is probably one of the most impactful disclosures of recent time, because a few weeks after this was made public, the Prime Minister of Iceland had to resign because his name was in these databases of offshore companies. I'd love to see some more about this. It's also about drone strikes. Most people think that drone strikes take place in war zones, and of course they do sometimes, but we know, thanks to another new whistleblower inspired by Snowden, who leaked this, for instance, and it's about where drone strikes occur and how often and how many are killed and all that shit. But it's also about who actually decides, and this is a targeting ladder. At the lower, in the bottom of it, it's military people who say we think this one should be killed, and then it goes to the Joint Chiefs of Staff and to the Secretary of Defense and to someone I don't know who is, and then it ultimately ends with the President of the United States. So it turns out that every Tuesday, the Nobel Peace Prize winning constitutional lawyer professor turned president, President Obama, have these Terror Tuesday meetings where he decides who should live and who should die. And oftentimes they have no idea who the people they're talking about are. Sometimes they're just a phone number or a SIM card number. Sometimes it's military-aged male or fun-sized terrorists if they are below the age of 15. We also have the, this is from a specific drone program in northern Afghanistan covering a period from May 1st to September 15th, so half a year, give or take, 3 months, 4 months. What it says is, the second line, kinetic strikes, that's drone strikes, boom. It says they had 27 operations. JP means jackpot. That means that in 19 of these operations, the intended target was killed. Well, that's a pretty good success rate, right? 70%, assuming you know who the victims are and they actually did something that warrants murder by drone. But the really interesting number is the second column, EKIA. It means enemy killed in action. And what enemy means in this context is a person killed. So they just count all who died in a drone strike and say that's enemies killed in action. So 19 people murdered because we wanted to murder them, presumably, and 155 other people dead too in the same drone strikes. So instead of a 70% success rate, that's actually a 90%. 90% of the people killed are just civilians. We have no idea who the fuck they are. Random people. So whoever leaked this is running a pretty big risk, because this is after Snowden and we all know that they don't like whistleblowers. So what this really tells us is that courage is contagious. Snowden said that when he stepped forward, and other people have said it afterwards, and I've said it for 3 years now, and I'll keep on saying it. The more people who leak stuff, the more other people will get inspired to leak stuff. And except for the few of you who works for the Danish Defense Intelligence Services, you're probably not in a position to leak stuff unless you have something very interesting side job somewhere. But some of you might be in a position to release stuff anyway. Either because you work somewhere and you somehow touch classified stuff, in which case I strongly encourage you to leak it, or because maybe you hack something. I'm not actually saying you should go black hat style, but if you are going black hat style, you should very much consider, instead of hacking teenage girls, maybe you should hack the Danish Department of Defense. So yeah, that's that. Also, you guys can help and have helped a lot by making encryption much more widespread and much more easy to use and much more easy to convince other people to use. When I started out doing whatever it is I'm doing right now, almost nobody had a clue how to encrypt anything except for people like you. Now I routinely get encrypted emails, sometimes very badly done, but, well, I guess intention matters, from journalists from mainstream media. And they are also always very proud of the fact that they have somehow managed to encrypt their emails or just installed Signal on their phones. And we really should encourage that, because it is a steep learning curve. And it's really good that people are doing it. So please make encryption even more easy to use, easier, more widespread. Ellsberg was the guy who leaked the Pentagon Papers. He said, on big posters across Washington, D.C. last year, he said, don't do what I did. Don't wait until a new war has started. Don't wait until thousands more have died before you tell the truth with documents that reveal lies or crimes or international projections of costs and dangers. Well, the last part is a bit unsexy, but who cares? I spent some days with Ellsberg in Copenhagen in 2004. before WikiLeaks, before Snowden. And he said two things over and over again, not like a madman, but in conversation. He said, the first thing we have to know is that the only way to avoid criminal policies, and he meant stuff like torture and widespread spying and wars of aggression and all that stuff, pretty much what went on to happen, is with insiders, with documents, tell the story to the media. But even then, he said, it's not sure that the media will do their job and report on these matters in a way that ordinary people can understand. But it's the only shot we have. And I didn't quite get the last part of his statement back then, before WikiLeaks. And then it turned out, this was 2004, that was exactly at the same time that this guy, Thomas Tam, we saw before, tried to tell the New York Times that George Bush was spying on all Americans. And the New York Times sat on the story for over a year until George Bush was re-elected. It was a close election. If they had broken the story when they got it in 2004, George Bush would probably not have been re-elected. So, fuck them. That's why Snowden didn't go to the New York Times, actually. We need better media. We need better politicians. And we definitely need more tech people to speak out. So, thanks for being here and speak out, goddammit. Yeah, that's it. Hello, are you here? No. Yeah.
Is it true that an organization like the Help Wizard?
Well, that's awkward. Yeah. I didn't bring my notes. I probably should have, because what I was supposed to say in the very beginning is that I'm a
hello.
I'm a co-founder and board member of, wait for it, a Danish whistleblower organization called Veron. It means speak the truth in Esperanto. But I'm here in a personal capacity because I'm pretty sure they wouldn't condone of me always encouraging people to break the law and stuff. But yeah, we do have this whistleblower organization. This is a Danish Ministry of Justice. He has blocked me on Twitter for some reason. You should go check it out, Veron.
veron.dk.
It's in Danish so far, but we're actually working on on hooking up with some other organizations around the world, like Courage Foundation, and in the US they have an organization called Expose Facts, which does pretty much the same thing. That the idea is to encourage whistleblowing and help actual whistleblowers when they step forward economically with lawyers, press thing, so they don't have to stand all alone and face the music, so to speak. We can face some of the music for them. We had our first case last year, I think, with a Danish prison guard, a very nice lady called Marianne Jørgensen, who stepped forward and testified about horrible conditions in prison where a guard had choked a female inmate and called her a cunt. That's, of course, is bad behavior, but that wasn't really the case. The case was that Marianne, she reported it, the incident, and it ended up in court, and the whole prison system backed this this prison guard, not her and not the inmate, and that's pretty shitty behavior. In the end, she won, or sort of won. The other guy lost and was sentenced for something, but now she is without the job, and that's not funny. I lost track, sorry. But yeah, we should definitely help whistleblowers more. We should appreciate them. Actually, the other day, it was in US, it was National Whistleblower Appreciation Day, which sounds silly, but it's actually a federal instated day, because historically, the US had a rather healthy relationship to the concept of whistleblowers. They're probably one of the countries on the planet with best whistleblower protection laws. Except for this national security exemption, where they, well, Daniel Ellsberg, the Vietnam War era whistleblower, he was the first whistleblower to be charged with espionage, which is a death penalty giving potentially charge. And from 1971, where he was charged with espionage meant for prosecuting foreign spies, not whistleblowers, and up until 2001, a grand total of 3 persons, including him, was charged with espionage. Under Obama, 9 people has been charged with espionage. So everybody hated George Bush, who was a primitive, ugly, stupid Texan cowboy. But Obama is worse than Bush in this regard. And that's really something that will turn out to be the most shameful part of his legacy, I think. Also not closing Guantanamo Bay in 8 years, even though he campaigned on it. But yeah, it's a close call. Whistleblower Appreciation Day. So they do have that, where they're supposed to celebrate the federal government and Pentagon and all that, brave people speaking truth to power. And while, of course, they were having this National Whistleblower Appreciation Day, news broke that Jeffrey Sterling, the African-American CIA agent, analyst we saw before, he was close to dying in prison because he was being denied medical care on Whistleblower Appreciation Day, no less. So fuck them.
Other questions? No? Let's give Peter a hand.